There's a stain on my garment, dear Aisha, dear Aisha. There's a stain on my garment, dear Aisha, a stain.
Tell me, how did it get there, Mohammed, Mohammed? Tell me, how did it get there, Mohammed? Tell me.
Sexy slave girls, dear Aisha, dear Aisha, dear Aisha. Sexy slave girls, dear Aisha, I just lost control. There's Maria Al-Kubtia, Rayana bin Sayed, Ayman, and others. You know I can't wait.
But Bilal's calling out, son, Mohammed, Mohammed. Now it's time for the salad, Mohammed, it's time.
Then scrape it, dear Aisha, dear Aisha, dear Aisha. Then scrape it, dear Aisha, dear Aisha, scrape it.
Sahih Muslim 572-3377, Surah 66, Al-Bukhari 232, Surah 424.
Allah is a false god, a false god, a false god. Allah is a false god, a false, false god. Allah is a false god, a false god, a false god. Allah is a false god, a false, false god. And Muhammad is not a prophet. Muhammad is not a prophet. If you want grace and mercy and love, Islam is not for you. But Jesus is the way, the truth, the way, the truth and the life. Jesus is the King of Kings who died to save us all. If you just repent and believe he took your sins on the cross, then mercy and grace, forgiveness and love, eternity can be yours. But Allah is a false god, a false god, a false god. Allah is a false god, a false, false god.
Hallelujah, let Lord Jesus Christ shine forth. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are joining us. Welcome to another live stream with us. And Dr. David Woody is with us.
How you doing?
Brother, what happened to you? You shaved?
I had to play Jeffrey Epstein in Muhammad's Boom Boom Room. And so Epstein didn't have a beard. So I will shave my beard. I don't like shaving my beard, but I will shave it to make fun of Muhammad. So I'm about to record Muhammad meets Alexander the Great. So I don't know if Alexander had a beard or not, but seen some Christian Hijab here said he still has Epstein look. Oh, there's another comment. Pete, someone is asking about the part in my hair. I could go ahead and explain that one too.
Yes, I was gonna ask that. Yeah. Yes, what happened to you?
After being married, I've almost always, except for like, you know, I guess maybe like 13, 14 years ago or something like that, my hair was a little bit longer and so on. But I've mainly had like a military cut my entire life. I always like it short. I don't have to comb it. I get out the shower. I don't have to do anything and so on. Meanwhile, after being married for 20 years to my wife, she tells me she doesn't like short, spiky hair. And she says she wants me to have longer hair. And a younger David Wood would say, well, I don't care. It's my hair. I like it short. But the older David is like, man, this lady has put up with me 20 years and she just wants my hair to be longer. Okay. But the problem is I have no idea how to comb like longer hair. Like, what do? I comb it back? Do I part it? So I'm trying to figure this out as I'm going along. Anyway, that's the idea. And people who are complaining, David, what look at your hair looks stupid, blah, blah, blah. Guys, sorry. My wife trumps you on all of this.
So how come she didn't say anything for 20 years?
I don't know. Yeah, I might not have, but yeah, I mean, I'm telling you, 10 years ago, just even like 10 years ago, I'd have been like, I don't care. You don't tell me how to do my hair. Whereas now it's like anything this woman says, after all the stuff we've been through, she can say anything. Anything you want. Anything you want, dear.
Okay, thanks for sharing that very basic principle of marriage with us.
It's good marriage advice. You learn this stuff after
20 years.
Yeah, it takes a while to stuff to sink in.
Okay. I ask you to jump into the live stream. Sorry, join me in the live stream because people are just curious what you are up to. And they're dropping me emails. And then there are channels are kind of circulating around. Your new videos are coming up. I just thought you come and give us a quick update. What have you been up to? What are those new channels?
So few months back, I said I was going to delete the channel and then ended up giving it to you. And it was because I came up with a different way of doing things that'll make it way harder to ban me in the long run. And it's pretty straightforward on how to go about it, but it's taking way longer than I thought. And it's mainly because everything always takes way longer than I think it will. I have a problem. Like I'm the guy who sits there watching the MMA fight going, man, I could take these guys, right? And I know I can't, right? But I feel like I could. But that's how I feel like everything. And it's like that with this line. What? You got this ideology that's supposed to be taking over the world a few years. Man, I could take this. But I'm like that with time. Like I always, like, I think it'll take me like a couple hours to make a video and it'll end up taking me like a week to make a video. So I was going to, I started putting this new plan into motion, but, there's always like family drama and disasters all over the place going around. And it's usually like one or two things going along. Whereas occasionally like everything hits all at once and just kind of buries me in stuff I gotta do all day. So anyway, just a couple months ago, our landlord, so we were renting a house and our landlord, he didn't know that we had disabled kids, and apparently he's a Korean guy, apparently he comes from some area where they view it as like a demonic thing or something like that. It's some sort of like, I don't know, they think it's like bad luck or something like this to have disabled people on your property or something like that. So they actually kicked us out. I didn't say that's what they kicked us out for. He clearly was freaked out by our kids and then told us he's not renewing our lease. So anyway, then we had to find a different place, only it's, we got five kids, two of them completely disabled, their muscles don't work. And so had to find it. It's kind of tricky finding a place where you can have, you know, wheelchair access or, you know, build a ramp or something like that and not have the place that you're renting from have a problem with, you know, modifying things. And so it's all that's tricky. And then, so we had to move. And then, even with our kids throughout COVID, they were very limited on, you know, hospital trips and so on, because they have all kinds of medical problems. But we're trying to keep the hospital trips to a minimum during COVID and so on. But then once COVID let up, like now, you got to catch up on all the stuff that built up for a couple years and the different appointments they needed and so on. But here's the thing: so if you have a baby whose muscles don't work, well, you have a kind of floppy baby. It's called floppy baby when they're born. You've got a baby, so you can carry around a baby even if the baby's muscles don't work. Now they're teenagers, so now we have two teenagers whose muscles don't work, and that's just something else entirely. So we've got that. We've got lots of medical appointments and stuff. And then my brother. I don't know why I'm telling everyone this, but it's a lot of people know my family history. But my brother John's been locked up for a couple of years for some drug charges. He just finally got sentenced. And I didn't even know they could do this. But it's basically his wife died. our mom died of an overdose. Our other brother, Manny, OD'd and got brain damage. And then COVID hit, and all my brother John was doing was working. COVID hit, he lost his job, they got shut down, and he relapsed, went back to drugs. And so they locked him up for drugs. But when they caught him, his kid was in the car with the drugs, right? That's bad. You shouldn't have drugs around it. Well, you shouldn't be doing the drugs, but you definitely shouldn't have them around the kid. Anyway, he's been locked up for a couple years. They finally sentenced him. And basically, since my brother has lost absolutely everything, the only thing he had to look forward to was seeing his kid when he got out of prison. And then the judge said, in addition to his prison sentence, he cannot see his son for 25 years. And I was like, what? How can a judge say you can't see your son for 25 years? I mean, I don't know. That sounds weird to me. I'm very anti-drug, and that sounds like insane. Because they don't hit like pedophiles with stuff like that. And so the idea that he had drugs in his car, and so they're doing that anyway. That just happened a couple weeks ago, and then so my brother's like now he's suicidal and stuff because he's lost everything. He's lost absolutely everything. And then my brother Manny, who no one expected him to do as well as he has, because, I mean, he was in a coma. His brain had, like, melted. The stuff that they were draining out of his body, it was black. That's how messed up his system, because his organs shut down. They've got this bucket beside him. He's draining this black goop into it from outside, from his body and stuff. So didn't think he's going to recover. Now he's only affected like he thinks normally, but his speech is messed up, and his motion is impaired, but he recovered a lot. But we've always had we have some mental health problems in my family, and Manny's always been a little paranoid. But after his overdose and coma, periodically gets really, really paranoid, like thinking everyone around him is conspiring to kill him and things like that. And so he just has to be institutionalized during that point. He has to go to a mental hospital for that until he sort of calms back down. But so anyway, it's all stuff like that, but it's all like been happening like right now. And then just like in addition to that, we moved into this place, and this place is fake. In other words, everything in this place is broken, and they basically sort of held it together to get someone to move in. Because you can do that, right? You can have something that's broken, and you can sort of patch it up into a quick fix, until knowing that it's going to break a month later after someone moves in and stuff. And so anyway, and then every single thing I'm doing right now, like there's a microwave above the oven, and that microwave died. I'm like, oh, no problem. It's an old garbage microwave. I'll just go ahead and put in a new one. So I go and buy a new one to go in the same spot. Problem is, turns out to be half an inch bigger, because this thing is like Stone Age. Turns out to be half an inch bigger. It won't fit. So guess who has to remodel everything just to get this thing in, because it goes in between these cabinets and the tiles and stuff like that. Anyway, this point is, something that should be really easy, a new microwave, turns into like a 3-day project, and I'm sitting there cutting tiles and breaking tiles on the wall and stuff like that. Anyways, but that's just the most recent example, but it's like every day something like that's happening. And so anyway, plan is coming together, just taking a while. And for anyone who's thinking, oh no, look at these disasters, that this is, I don't know how life is like for the rest of you. It's just life. So this is, I mean, that's the D Wood family. So,
yeah, it seems unique life, unique. Just a couple of things. So you had to change your outlook, because after 20 years, your wife said, time for changing your hat.
Yeah.
And then you had to change the house because landlord didn't allow you to stay there longer. That seems a bit like, I know in Middle East, in Muslim majority countries and in Africa, if you've got a child who is not well, then that's seen like very negative thing. people has the same issue. I find it strange in US people have the same attitude, actually. That's sad.
Yeah, it is weird because like if I were renting a place and I found out that, you know, I mean, if I owned a property and I was renting it to someone else and I found out they have like disabled kids, I would want to like help, like, how can I help you? Like, what can I do? But yeah, apparently there are like, get that kid away from, right? They're like that. So yeah, pretty weird.
Compassion is gone in this broken world. And you expressed that for your brother, he can't see his son for 25 years. So like, I would expect, for example, in England, legal age limit is 18. So after 18, child is independent. They can do whatever they want. Why there is like this 20 years?
I have no idea. I had no idea that was a thing. I had no idea he could even say you can't go around your son, especially for, now, again, I get it. Having drugs around your kid, and you know, what people don't understand is like, when you're on drugs, you're messed up. Like my brother, when he's not on drugs, would lay down his life for anyone in his family in a heartbeat. He gets on drugs and they change, right? I mean, you just change. And so you can have people who get on drugs and will like steal from their own family. And you'd think, oh, what a dirtbag stealing from his own family. And it's like, well, no, he wouldn't normally steal from his own family. He's a person, the drugs take over your system and your thinking gets completely messed up. You'll do anything for it and so on. So, so with someone and I've written the judge and stuff. I'm like, look, all you would have to do, my brother's only messed up like this when he gets hooked on meth and everything and heroin and everything else. When he's not on that stuff, he's fine. So all you need to do is get him away from that area where he always ends up falling in with the old crowd and gets on drugs. Send him to me. He can work for me. I'll train him. I'll send him to school to do camera work and stuff like that. And he'll be around Christians all day, every day, never be around any drugs, never be around any of those influences. And the problem solved. You won't have any more problems. They won't do it. And no, it's go right back out to the same. And they won't let you leave. They won't let you leave the state. You end up in the same spot around the same people. And it's inevitable. So, you know, he's going to get out in a couple years. And I mean, what, he's got nothing to look forward to. You know, he's lost everything. And it's like, how long do you actually think he's going to make it? I'm convinced he can make it if you're around me, but up there, no family anymore, no nothing. Just getting out, and I mean, he'll get out and he'll work for a while, but you eventually have a really bad day. You eventually have a really bad day. And if you're a drug addict, you know, different people turn to different things, right? Like some people have a bad day and they'll get drunk. Some people have a really bad day and they'll overeat. If you're a drug addict, if you're a former heroin addict and meth addict and everything else addict, and you just get totally stressed out and messed up, it's let me do this once for old time's sake, and then you're hooked again. And the thing is, I don't know how to avoid that, right? Like, he's going to have some really bad days getting out, especially with he's lost everything. He's going to have some bad days. So I don't know how to avoid it, except for like radical change, like getting him completely out of that environment and into a completely new one. But yep, that's the system. The system's messed up.
It is like when you lose all the hope, there is, life is different when you can't see, and especially when the people who's supposed to be judging and good in judging system, legal system, when they messed up, you fall into the system and then you mess up. Mm-hmm. And you've got the house, which is like just trying to stand by itself with all these broken. Anything anyone can do to help besides like now?
No, we're fine. I mean, the plus side is it's a, we found a, it's a big house. It's a big house. It looks nice. It looks like a really nice house. It's just, you get in here and it has, I'm sure this place was really, really nice when it was made. Just no one has ever bothered to fix anything in this place. Now, the plus side is when we eventually leave this place, it will be pretty well fixed up. Because I'll eventually fix all this stuff. So
it will be brand new, ready to be sold or something.
It's just really annoying because I was like really excited. I'm gonna make all these videos, and I had like this list of all these topics, and I actually have content prepared to where, I mean, I could post regularly for a year, and I've already got all the topics and the content prepared and stuff like this. And it's just every day I wake up and there's like all these 10 things to do, and okay, well, I'll record tomorrow, and then tomorrow gets there, and there's all these things I have to do, and so it's just anyway, I like making videos and stuff, and it gets frustrating to not be able to do it because there's like a bunch of other stuff going on. Anyway,
okay, I'll.
What is this? Jacob Emanuel says, David, I think you ought to grow your beard back. Duh. Thanks for the input, Jacob. You missed the whole part about how I shaved it for a part so I could play Jeffrey Epstein. What'd you think? Hey, I shaved it so I could play Jeffrey Epstein. Now let me look like Jeffrey Epstein my entire life. That's my plan.
People don't like seeing different things.
Yeah, yeah. Like I didn't have a beard until I was like, what, 37, 38 or something like that. But now when you shave, I feel like your face is naked. You know what I mean? I feel like I'm walking around naked.
There are lots of people trying to get rid of their fabric and then walk around naked. So probably now you know what they feel.
Like the women in Iran taking off their hijabs.
They're not only taking off their hijabs, a couple of them took off their tops. It was on the social media to say like, no to hijab, I can wear whatever I want to wear.
Hey, look at all these perverts over in the comments. They're like, what? Let me go look this up. Perverts, man. I got all these perverts watching your show, and they're all sitting there Googling topless Iranian women protest.
I can't remember which part of the world it was, but to support the woman in Iran. So apparently almost 100 women is being killed, and some of the women are missing now. Why? Because approximately 2 weeks ago, Mahsa Amini was killed or killed and died under the protection of the morality police because her hijab was not put in its full form. What do you think, David?
And it's a weird situation because, I mean, you go back to like the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring back in the day. That was so you had all these Muslim nations in the Middle East and Northern Africa. So it included places like, so it's Libya and Syria, Iraq, and so on. And geniuses over here in the West said, you know, what worked over here in the United States, we had to deal with the tyrant. Well, we got rid of the tyrant, and then democracy and everything else flourished over here. So that's what we need to do over there. Just get rid of all these tyrants. So get rid of Saddam Hussein and Assad and Gaddafi and all these guys, and then everything's going to be wonderful over there. And you know what they don't realize is you had a lot of people who just wanted to go on killing sprees there as well. In other words, in Iraq, you had people who had the mentality of ISIS already there. They were just scared of Saddam, and you have people like that in Libya and so on. And so we're sitting there getting rid of the evil dictator. And keep in mind, these guys are scumbags, right? Saddam's a scumbag. Gaddafi, he was a scumbag. Gaddafi was a scumbag. These are terrible, terrible people. But they were sort of terrible to everyone. And the jihadis were scared of them. And so these guys, by being dictators, were able to keep the terrorists under control for the most part. We go get rid of the guy that the terrorists are scared of, and now the terrorists have nothing to be scared of anymore. And hey, why did this turn into a bloodbath, and why did you get ISIS and all these other things? We can't figure it out. And so the idea of, you know, the West supporting, you know, this revolution and so on doesn't work in certain places. What's weird is Iran seems like the place where it actually could work. It seems like you've got so many people there who are sick of, you know, the religious dictators that, you know, if the people win, it seems like you may have dealt with a big problem, because Iran really, really wants to be nuclear. And Iran is really, really bad as far as supporting terrorism and so on, supporting terrorists. And so if you actually had a change of government there, looks like, you know, you could solve a lot of the world's problems. And yet that's like the one of all these people who actually want freedom there. And no one wants to support them except on, like, you know, Twitter or something like that. But
YouTube.
What's that?
Twitter and YouTube.
Yeah. And yeah, it's a wild situation. But I mean think about this. And matter of fact, I just tweeted a woman who was complaining because the New York Times said that the protests there are about the economy and the nuclear deal. And she just went off. She's like, what are you talking about? It's like, we don't want to be told how to dress by these guys who are killing us in the streets for not dressing the way they say we have to dress. That's what we're protesting. You guys are talking about the nuclear deal and so on. And so it's like, it's not even getting reported on accurately. Yeah. And stuff. And so it must really, really suck to be a woman in Iran. You recognize, hey, we have to stand up. They're killing women. We have to stand up. We have to stand up against this. We have to take a stand. And they just keep killing you. And, you know, other nations won't even report on it correctly. And so it's got to be a lonely feeling.
What do you think solution is?
Yeah, I don't know. Because, lots of times when the West, you know, actually gets involved, like, hey, let's go over there and do something, it usually ends disastrously because we never do anything right. But I don't know. Seems like there's, yeah. At least help them by letting the world know exactly what's going on, right? I mean, that should be on every news channel constantly, everything they're doing, every time those police. Because I'm sure you've seen the video, and it's not just police. It's if a woman takes off her hijab and is walking down the street, they view it as any man can walk up to her and punch her in her face. And I've seen that, right? I said, this guy, like, riding on the motorcycle, he turns and sees a woman without a hijab, gets off, goes over and clocks her. And
even in the bus,
yeah,
if woman takes off her hijab, suddenly she gets beaten by stranger.
Yeah, and you can see the connection to the Quran. Surah 33 says that you put on the hijab. And keep in mind, that's if we're interpreting as, you know, cover your ornaments or whatever, we're interpreting as just the hijab and not like a full burqa or niqab or something like this. But the Quran says you wear this covering so that you won't be molested. So the implication is if a woman isn't wearing it, then she wants to be molested. She wants to be attacked, she wants to be assaulted, she wants to be raped, something like that. And then so you have an entire society that absorbs that idea. And the police, this woman's taking off her hijab. Well, we know what she wants. And again, I mean, the people will be charged repeatedly with spreading corruption in the land. That comes directly from the Quran. You're spreading corruption in the land, Surah 5, verse 33. And the penalty is death or dismemberment or exile, crucifixion, things like that for this vague crime of spreading corruption in the land. But you absorb those ideas that, you know, women who don't cover themselves appropriately are asking for it. And if you're bigger concern for them, they're spreading corruption. So you're on social media taking pictures of yourself and you're going to spread this idea to other women. Well, you're spreading corruption in the land. That's a death sentence. And so, yeah, going and killing these women and somehow, if you and me are condemning it, then we're Islamophobes and shame on us.
Yeah. I saw a message was stating, who do you think you are? You are talking about it since this is what Allah and Islam teaches. And then there was another message was identifying. So women are cutting their hair as well as getting rid of their hijab. So throwing hijab, getting rid of it and cutting hair, they are crime. So don't do it. Hijab is the symbol of Islam. Apparently you shouldn't burn it. You shouldn't burn it or tear it off. But it's quite okay to stay silent when a woman is being killed. Simply her hijab was not put fully. Like she's got hijab, but it is not put fully in its form. Just seems to me strange in 21st century. And it becomes more strange when we are silent. Like you just said, even newspaper is not giving us what is happening in reality.
Yeah, and I mean, when I think long term, because you asked, you know, what can be done? I mean, the real solution to all this is to expose Islam so that no one takes it seriously anymore, right? And the problem there is, it's like, okay, media, you journalists, you politicians, you educators, Hollywood, all you intellectuals out there, if you don't want to deal with this or do anything to support the people who are suffering because of this, fine. Shut up and stay out of our way. Stay out of our way. We'll take care of Muhammad. We'll take care of Muhammad. We'll take care of the Quran. We will expose it. It'll take a little while, but we will expose it until Muhammad is the laughing stock of history. And how could anyone have ever taken this guy seriously? But you've got this problem, like, you know, these women being killed in the streets. The long-term solution to that is for us to expose Muhammad as a false prophet so that people stop killing for this dude. And yet everyone comes after us. It's like, you, Hatun, you're almost public enemy number one of, you know, in the UK there, like the worst person imaginable to the government and the police and so on. And for what? For exposing Muhammad and standing up for freedom of speech and so on makes you a horrible person. It's like, okay, so the very people who are trying to do something to deal with this massive problem are the ones that have to be targeted by the governments and so on. So, I mean, as far as, you know, what to do about this, it's, look, get involved in exposing Muhammad or get out of the way of the people who are. And that's it. It'll be problem solved.
Something strange happened. So I got harmed and my property got harmed. And I decided to go to the police because it's just causing some problems. And then, so I've got the footage and then I've got the picture as well. I went to the police to report it. My intention was only to report it because recently police made a claim about certain things. And I expressed this has happened, I've got the footage. And then she said, so can you, before like just typing everything, officer says, can you describe them to me? And then I said, well, there are two Muslims. And then lady just stopped and then says, how do you know they are Muslim? Look at the picture. So I'm trying to show him the picture. Like they look like Muslim and they were Muslim anyway. And then
because according to them, I mean, it doesn't matter. They could be shouting Allahu Akbar, dressed in full Islamic gear with a Quran in their hand.
Yeah, still they are not Muslim. And,
well, that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, and officer says, what are their names? I just like, I don't know. So you don't know their names, you don't know their surnames, but you know they are Muslim. I'm just like, I've got the footage, so I'm just like trying to make my point. And then, do you know where they live? Officer asks me, and then I'm just like, I don't know, they are not my friend. I don't go to Botanic Garden with them. And then officer again asks, so you don't know their name, you don't know where they live, and you are here to complain about them. I'm just like, Well, I had been harmed. My property is being harmed. And then she said, well, I can't do anything. And then she just sent me back. So apparently next time when someone tries to like throw acid on me or do something, all I need to say, well, hold on a second. I just need your full name and your address so that we can do something about it.
And can you verify that you're a Muslim for them? So
yeah. That's, I think, second, first question that should be maybe. And then details later. Such a shame, just messed up things.
Yeah, it sure is.
So therefore, like standing up for what is happening in Muslims, like in this occasion, you are standing what is happening to Muslim woman in Muslim country. Yet you are still Islamophobe. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I was going to ask you, actually I did put a comment which was put by someone. Let me put that again.
David lost his beard. He's a woman now, according to Muhammad.
So I saw the comment, but also there was a video by Turkish imam. He was telling men to, they need to have their beard because they look like women. Therefore, they can easily have, men easily can have lustful desires towards those shaved men. Just don't be around Muslim men, David.
Yeah, I need to stay away before these guys start getting some thoughts about D-Dog Dizzle here.
Yeah, it's all over YouTube. This Turkish imam is stating that.
Now, what's crazy is you know this imam. You know this imam had been growing up, and every time he sees a guy without a beard, he's like, oh, I wonder if I can have some mutta with this guy, right? And so it's something creepy like that. And so he then projects that onto everyone else.
I was going to ask you a practical question on, so we've got Muhammad's birthday is coming. Are you aware of it?
No.
You're not aware of it? Muslims are going to celebrate the dead prophet's birthday this weekend.
Well, he is their idol.
So, I'm going to do some stuff for him. I guess I can get recipe from you. I have to make a birthday cake.
Oh, birthday cake for Muhammad. Hey, that's funny. You should have a birthday, Muhammad's birthday celebration live.
Yeah, I'm doing that on cake. Friday evening. I called it crashing the party.
Oh, darn. We have Elohim in the comments. Darn, she could have probably decorated a cake with a Muhammad cartoon.
She's supposed to come to the birthday party, so she has to bring the cake.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Elle, you might have to bring the cake.
Yeah. She can bring the cake. She just put the Muhammad on it.
And then we carve that thing up.
Yeah, I think she's working on it because she expressed, I still have time. So,
yeah.
You've got this website?
I got a couple things. Right now, there are
I think approximately 3 channels are putting up your videos. Do you want to kind of just tell us about them, David?
Yeah, so... I have a website, act17.com. I haven't been posting content there because they sent me the instructions and I have to learn how to do that. And so I keep doing other stuff instead of learning the process of putting up content. But that will soon have content on it. We have a private act17 community. And as far as YouTube channels, I have 2. I have Philosophy Underground and I have Apologetics Roadshow. Elle and her husband, your brother in Christ, are running sort of an unofficial official official, unofficial channel. So it's not, I mean, they own the channel and so on, but they're posting the polemical content. So part of the problem with the one big channel was I had stuff like Islamicize me on it. And then I have just normal apologetic stuff, but the whole channel would get banned for like Islamicize me. And so it would be shut down for a week and so on. And so I recognized the solution to that a while back was start dividing up the content, have apologetics content over here and other kinds of content in different spots so that if something gets banned, it doesn't shut everything down. So content is divided up. And so there are archive channels and stuff. And so the idea is, as far as people who still don't understand, you know, why not just keep the one channel? If I were to keep the one channel that kept getting banned, that stops everything. Because if that channel gets banned for a week, it's in the rules, I'm not allowed to post anywhere. So I'm not allowed to post on other channels. Now, if it's other people posting my polemical content or posting Muhammad's Boom Boom Room or something like that, if something gets flagged or something like that, it doesn't affect me on my other channels. I didn't post that. They posted that, right? So that's the idea behind keeping, you know, again, it's archive channel. So there are people who will be posting all the, you know, everything from David Wood. Guess what? That's them posting it. If something gets banned or something like that, that's them, right? Now on my channels, if I post something and it gets banned, I have to deal with that. But guess what? That doesn't affect the other people who are running archive channels or who are running, you know, a different David Wood site. And so it's a little messier having stuff spread around, but it's been a huge problem for like the last couple of years that as soon as I get any momentum going and I'm posting and stuff, oh, bam, shut down for a week. Then, you know, get started again. And 2 weeks later, oops, shut down for a week. And I'd eventually win them all. But the problem is they'll ban you and I'll be banned for a week. And it'll take me 3 weeks to get the ban to get the strike overturned. Well, guess what? I already served my sentence. I served my whole sentence. I mean, it's an insane policy. I mean, this would be like police just going up randomly, locking people up, throwing people in jail, and then keeping you there for a week and eventually get out. Oh, sorry, yeah, our bad. And just doing this regularly. But that's like that. I mean, these are the people who control YouTube. So we can't change them, but we can understand what they do and work around it.
So I put three channels in the description for people to subscribe it. And there are other channels, we will kind of put them up so people can follow what's going on there. I think we need to do some voting here now, David. So since Mohammed's birthday is coming and I'm doing live stream titled Crashing the Birthday Party, people are proposing lots of cake ideas. So we need to kind of come up with something. Everyone can bake the cake and then send me the picture. And you can't send me the piece of the cake because that would be so complicated. And then when I get all those birthday cakes, we can do competition and then pick the winner.
You know, it's funny. I was, as you're saying that, I was thinking, I'd like to make a cake, but my art skills aren't very good. And I was thinking, wait, that might make it hilarious.
Well,
it's like a horribly drawn, disfigured Muhammad.
Does Muhammad needs to eat tasty and good birthday cake? No, he's like awful. So what you expect is birthday cake is going to be awful too.
Yeah, especially like, you know, it's not regular milk and sugar. It's going to be like goat milk and sugar, like goat milk and date palms or something like
that. Do you put water?
Probably some camel urine.
Yeah. So if you put, instead of water, you can put camel urine.
Camel milk, goat milk, and dates would probably be like a good Muhammad cake. Okay. Oh, someone yeah,
so
put
you can buy camel milk.
Someone
you can buy camel milk. Camel urine, you can get it from the zoo. If you can't find camel urine, just like go to the closest farm and get urine from cow or from sheep. They should be said taste the same thing anyway.
Bart Connolly said breast milk.
Yeah.
That is probably what Muhammad would use.
And then, yeah, send us, make it, eat it, and then also send us the picture. And then we choose the winner.
I'll probably do mine like Muhammad being all green from when he was sick and dying.
This is going to be funny. I'm already like thinking lots of things now. I need to be friends with people who can bake things.
I'll probably just buy one and then like decorate it. Muhammad themed cake. It would be pretty funny to walk in because you have cake companies that will like can like put a picture on a cake. It would be funny to go in there with like a Muhammad cartoon and say, hey, can you put this on a cake and see what they say?
You can do online actually, order online. We did order holes in the narrative cake online. It just didn't come on time, but like you can just put picture on the cake, whatever you want, and then just order it. I'll try that.
Hey, you should get one of those next time Yasser Kadi's coming to town and deliver the cake to him. Or Muhammad Hijab, a speaker's corner, bring him a cake. Hey, I brought you a cake. Yeah. The holes in the narrative cake.
Actually, I can take I'm taking like Muhammad's pictures to speaker's corner on Sunday. I can take cake to as well.
Ooh, if you show up with a Muhammad cake and then cut it up and then start passing around pieces of cake to everyone. You could go up to like Ali Dawa and not tell him where his piece of cake came from, and he won't even realize he's eating Muhammad's face.
Yeah, I'll try that. I'll see how it works. Should be fun. Okay. There was something else I was going to ask you. People were talking about the video you just uploaded regarding the image of God.
That was actually, I'm not trying to repost, but there are a few videos that from my original channel, there are a few videos that I'm going to repost because of another video I'm going to be making. So that one is, I'm about to make a video called Elvis, the Image of God. And it was, it's actually because there's a recent movie about Elvis, but it gave the impression, it was actually a cool little part of the movie, but it was a young Elvis and he grows up and he's in a poor area and he's with his friends and they would go around and like peek through cracks and walls to see what's going on and so on. And so they go and they see people playing blues music and they see, you know, some ladies in there getting really wild over the music. But then he sneaks into a Pentecostal revival meeting and he just like starts shaking and stuff like this until they're like lifting him up and so on. And the impression that you got from that was like that he had a gift from God that he could then use that how to either, you know, serve worldly things or to serve God. But it's kind of like it's like all jumbled up in his head. But that the idea is, I mean, as far as the image of God, it's like that's how we all are, right? We all have gifts that we can use to glorify God and to be God's image. Or we could use those exact same gifts to serve ourselves or, you know, do horrible things. And so anyway, wanted to take some clips from that movie and make the point. But then I was, I had this other video called Norm Macdonald, The Image of God. And so I was like, okay, I'll repost that one. That way I can link the Elvis one back to that because the overall goal, because I made that one, I made one on Mark Zuckerberg, The Image of God. It's going to be the Elvis one. but I'm making completely different points in these videos about how human beings image God in different ways. But, you know, after years of doing this, the idea would be, I mean, the point I'm eventually trying to get across is people image God in a lot of different ways. And there are a lot of, there's a lot of depth to the meaning and so on. And people can do it in different ways. And if you see enough different people and understand how these different people are imaging God, then I don't know, I'm trying to get people to think about other human beings as imaging God and so on. So I think it's one of the most underrated doctrines. We hear it, we say it, but there's not a lot of study in it. When I think it's like, to me, it's like foundational to everything else. You know, I don't think you can understand that or the gospel or the incarnation or anything else without understanding what human beings are. So
someone is asking, could you make a video on how even Muhammad imaged God?
Yeah, you can. I mean, it'd be similar point to like with Elvis, in that, you know, you have whatever gifts. Like if you're Muhammad, you start this religion, you had to have some leadership abilities and ability to persuade other people to, if you're actually convincing people, if you're convincing women to breastfeed grown men with beards, you've got some ability to, you know, control and manipulate people and so on. But notice, if you weren't doing that for your own sick purposes, you could actually be doing good in this world. And so, yeah, that might be a fun one. Muhammad, the image of God.
Yeah. There is a question on how would you prove that the New Testament is a reliable source to Muslims or to atheists?
Those would be totally different. If I'm talking to an atheist, most of it is trying to get back. I mean, trying to get through a bunch of nonsense that people have absorbed, right? So it's just, I mean, for some reason, it's totally common to hear, the Bible you have today is a translation of a translation of a translation of a translation of a translation. And no, it's not. It's not, right? That people really think, the Bible is translated from Greek and into Latin and then into German. And then from the German, it's translated into English and blah, blah, blah. And so the meaning is all like distorted. No, it's not. Our translations now are translated directly from the original languages and so on. And so there's that. And then people have so many dumb ideas. And so, they think the gospels were written hundreds of years after the events and so on. It's total nonsense. So with an atheist, you probably start trying to get through some of those ridiculous ideas and, you know, saying, hey, these are first century documents. You have to establish effort. Like, can I show you that these are first century documents first? Okay. And then you can start going into, hey, these guys, at least for some of the content here, really seem to be eyewitnesses, because you can spot people writing about stuff and they're not actual witnesses, like the Gospel of Barnabas, right? Someone tries to write a gospel, and that happened a lot with apocryphal gospels and so on. Once people go and investigate, you find out the details of like the terrain and things like that, they don't match up with what people are saying in these gospels and so on. But you can show the gospel writers actually knew quite a bit about what they're talking about. So, you know, with them, it's stepwise. With Muslims, I'm not budging off the Islamic dilemma ever. If I'm talking to a Muslim, it's your book affirms my book. Notice it's like the issue of miracles, right? Like if I say Jesus rose from the dead and an atheist says, well, I don't believe in miracles. Well, with the atheist, the discussions are going to be about the possibility of miracles and so on. If a Muslim said, I don't believe in miracles, my response is not going to be a defense of miracles. It's going to be, what are you talking about? You're a Muslim. You're supposed to believe in miracles. The Quran says that Jesus performed miracles and so on. So what you don't get to you, my Muslim friend, do not get to use the same objection that an atheist would use because of you are committed to Islam. And so with defending the Bible, their book affirms our book. So I'm not going to, I mean, I will if someone's actually interested in, like, you know, historical information and so on. But generally, if a Muslim says, oh, but the Bible, blah, 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 it's going to be, whoa, your God and your prophet affirm the inspiration and the preservation and the authority of my book. Your God and your prophet command me to judge by the book that you are mocking. They say, David, you have to judge by this book, the Bible, and you, my Muslim friend, are mocking it. You're mocking your own God and your own prophet. How do you not realize that? And so, yeah, I'd respond differently.
And you wouldn't want to stand in front of Allah after mocking him. You wouldn't want to stand in front of Muhammad after you mock him.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, if it comes down to it, I'll make the point. Look, when Allah says right here, let the people of the gospel judge by what Allah has revealed therein. And when he says that Christians have no ground to stand upon unless we stand upon the gospel, and you mock it and say we don't have the gospel. And then Surah 7, verse 157, he says we're reading the gospel. He's talking about the gospel that we actually have. And you mock it and you say we don't have the gospel and we can't judge by and all this. Once you become aware of that, if you say I don't care, you don't sound like a Muslim anymore. It's like you sound like someone who hates Christianity and is using Islam as part of your rage against Christianity. But when I can show you your own prophet and your own God affirming my scripture and you dismiss it, it doesn't even sound like you're a Muslim anymore, right? I mean, if you were doing that with anything else in the Quran, I mean, notice the precedent they're setting. Anytime you don't like what Allah says, you just he means the opposite of what he said. Well, great. So say that about the hijab then. Maybe when he said hijab, he actually meant don't wear the hijab. Since when he says judge by the gospel, he means don't judge by the gospel because it's corrupt. Great. Then when he says, you know, wear the hijab so that you won't be molested, he means don't wear the hijab.
It's always, I think it's essential that we help our Muslim friends or your Muslim friends who are asking the question to stand under the authority of the Quran. So Allah and Muhammad is their authority. They need to submit to that. So if they know much better than Allah and Muhammad, then maybe they should take the job of being Allah or the Prophet. Unless they are doing that, that's fine. If they are not doing, then we keep them accountable what Islam teaches. As David would say, Allah and Muhammad affirms the reliability of the Christian scripture. So keep Muslims accountable to that. Have you got last thoughts or last comments, David? I have been you for an hour now.
Oh, yeah. What's cool? What's really cool is I feel like we're just getting started. You know what I mean? We've been doing stuff for years. And when I think about it, and when I think about like what's to come, it's all been like warm up and practice and rehearsal. And the coolest stuff is still about to come out. And so people are worried about the stuff that goes on in the world or worried about Islam and so on. I think we are in the coolest spot in all of history. If you're a Christian, you want to reach Muslims with the gospel, you do not want to be in any other place in history. You want to be right here, right now. Because if you want to see Islam crumble, you do not want to be the past four. You would not want to trade places with anyone from the past 14 centuries. We're the generation that gets to see this collapse. And that's pretty awesome.
I find it's encouraging. Like, I think before lockdown, I would get lots of emails. Like, people are just like not happy what we are doing at Speaker's Corner stuff. Since lockdown, like, I get like more emails. People are saying, well, I left Islam, and then help me to become a Christian. What I can do, how can I look into Bible stuff? So number of those emails like increasing and increasing. People in Muslim majority countries are expressing they don't believe in Islam anymore. So like, it is right time to be alive.
And I mean, think about this. There are all those people, I mean, which Muslims themselves are calling an avalanche. There are all these people leaving Islam, and that's with very few people exposing it, and it's with all these systems of authority trying to protect it, right? I mean, politicians trying to protect it from criticism, journalists trying to protect it from criticism, the entire education system trying to tell kids how wonderful it is, all of Hollywood praising it as this wonderful, great ideology, and people are still catching on and leaving it with, you know, it's like YouTubers and stuff who are exposing it. Just imagine if we get to the point where politicians aren't protecting it from criticism anymore, and journalists aren't protecting it from criticism anymore, and we can all freely spread the facts about Islam. That is one ideology where as soon as the facts about Muhammad become common knowledge, that is they're complaining about the avalanche already, but they haven't seen an avalanche yet.
Yeah, even like now, also through YouTube, once any Dawa members, Dawa gangs kind of publicly intentionally lies, that's been exposed. Like we recently put up a video where Mr. Ketchup,
Sheikh Uthman. Yeah, I saw that one. Where he was claiming that this is he had Uthman's Quran, and it was. I mean, I only saw the clips, but it looked like, was that Fareed who was Fareed exposing him and saying he knows that's just an attribute. He knows that's just what it's called. It's not actually Uthman's Quran. Yeah. But no, I mean, if you see like Sheikh Uthman and Hijab and Ali Dawa, Yasser Qadhi, it's one thing to say something that is not true and you're just wrong. You're sincerely wrong. These guys know they're lying, right? When we have video clips of Sheikh Yasser Qadhi that are meant for the public, and he says not one letter's difference anywhere in the Quran since the time of Uthman, he knew that was a lie. Like, this is not, oh, he found out later that there are differences. He knew then, because we have other videos where he's talking to students of knowledge. And then in those cases, he's saying, yes, in different parts of the Muslim world, we use these, you know, we have the different qirats and they have different words and letters and blah, 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 blah. He's saying the exact opposite of what he's telling the popular audience. And, you know, that's just what these, you're dealing with liars. You're dealing with people who think it's okay to go out and lie for our religion in order to, if it's going to convince people to convert to Islam. And so you see someone like Sheikh Uthman. Sheikh Uthman lies in every conversation. He will say anything. The difference is he's been doing it for years, and now people are actually catching on, and they're starting to expose him. And really, I mean, all anyone would have to do, I mean, if someone wanted to have a lot of fun, just go find videos of Sheikh Uthman and look up what he's saying. Look up what he's saying. You're going to find lots of lying, because that is someone who thinks, hey, as long as I'm strengthening the ummah with my lies are fine. And dude, that might have been a brilliant approach back in the 90s for Ahmed, you know, Ahmed Dida back in the day, or for Zakir Naik, his followers. Might have been a good approach back then. We're in a different time right now. Now you lie and people are gonna call you on it. And that's only going to happen more and more, right? Because these guys, they're going to get caught more and more, and they may eventually try to adapt and try to not make it so easy to expose them. But I mean, like Sheikh Uthman's still in this mode where he thinks he's totally safe. And it's like, I mean, it's just hilarious that he actually thinks he could go out there. And Fareed's saying he knows it. He knew that was nonsense. And yet he'll say it anyway, thinking somehow it's not going to be exposed, and yet it is. And he seems to know his crowd, because most of his followers, they don't care. And that's part of exposing Islam. See, when Sheikh Uthman lies and gets caught and his followers don't care, you're sort of like, look at what Islam does. I mean, is that your religion that's making people like that not care that you're lying and think it's okay to lie? It's weird stuff.
I guess it takes people back to what kind of God they worship. So you would represent, like as a Christian, we are accountable to be truthful because our God is truth, versus Muslims lie and then it becomes like their daily job. Why? Because character of Allah is the best of deceivers. Muslims are simply representing and it becomes so normal, no one steps in and then says, oh, like, you shouldn't be doing that, stop doing that, stop doing that. It becomes just daily life. You just lie and lie. It's the same like on the preservation of the Quran. Everyone lies to you when you are a child. Your father, who is biologically programmed to love you, lies to you about Quran. Your imams, who are programmed to train you, they lie to you. Everyone lies to you. And then once something happens out of blue, out of pink, you just figure out you've been lied to and then you don't want to do anything with it. Same with those Dawa gangs. They actively and intentionally lie. And then people who watch them, like even if one of them just says, okay, this needs to stop. I don't want to be involved with the ideology, just promotes lying and lying and lying. Shouldn't like, people walk away? People will walk away.
Yeah, and I mean, and I think about it. I mean, like, really, all of modern dawah is based on deception. All their arguments, like you said, their main argument for you, perfect preservation of the Quran. It was a lie, right? Your average Muslim who was saying it actually believed it. Their scholars, they knew that was a lie. They knew that. Their Sheikh Yasser Qadis and so on, they knew that was a complete, total lie. They knew there are differences in different parts of the world, and they knew that there are differences in the manuscripts and so on. The scientific arguments, it's all lies. I mean, you have to be like horrible. I mean, a horrible, horrible person to twist these verses into what they claimed they were saying. But it's, I mean, all of, and then them saying that, according to Islam, the Bible's been corrupted. What? You're lying. You're lying. If you've read the Quran, you know that's a lie. And so it's all of modern dawah is based on deception. And, you know, because Allah is the best of deceivers, that's they think that's fine. But they're living in an age where now it's very easy to expose the lies when we see them. So much harder back in the day. I mean, if you're back in the day and Zakir Naik's giving a lecture and he's giving a lecture to, let's say, 1,000 people or something like that, and he lies, how do you expose him? We can run up to someone afterwards and say, you're wrong. That was wrong, Zakir Naik. I mean, now you can make a video exposing the lie. And I don't think that's the thing. It's when you have this entire structure and the confidence is all based on lies and we expose the lies, there's nothing to prop it. There's nothing to prop it up anymore. And so it's got nothing to do but collapse.
Yeah. Okay, I think we will finish very soon because it's been just over an hour. There are, I think, some people weren't with us at the beginning, David. People are still very much missing you. Can you be kind enough and once again remind people where they can find you and how they can follow the work you are doing?
You can check out channels. Apologetics Roadshow, X17 Polemics, Philosophy Underground. You can check those out. But it's best to completely ignore everything I say. Because I made how many videos explaining what I was going to do and what the reasons are, and yet I'll get 200 messages a day. David, hey, why did you start new channels? I don't get it. Makes no sense. You had a big channel, blah, blah, blah. And then I'll just be like, no, I'm not explaining it here again. What? It's like, dude, I can't sit there explaining everything. Have any idea how annoying that is? Like, okay, I made 3 videos and it was clear. Like once I saw from the first one, people interpreted it as I'm never going to be on YouTube or something. I was like, oh, okay. They're interpreting it that way. That's not what I said. And it's the opposite of what I said, but, let me explain it more clearly. I post another video. And then, people still don't get it. Let me post another video. Oh, let me do a bunch of live stream. They still don't get it. It's like...
I think most, for me, like, strange, funny, strange one was in California. when they ask you to come to the stage and then tell them why you shut down your channel and what are your plans now.
Yeah.
I just thought that was sad because you would expect them to like know by that time what you've been up to. But anyway. Yeah, probably people will ask again what happened to David Wood and where is he? What happened to his channels?
Watch. You'll get there will be comments on this video. But why did David?
I felt I was like your PA. I'm answering those emails.
And where's the beard? Where's the beard, David? And they'll ask this on videos. Why? Where exactly? Where we explain it? They'll ask it in the anyway.
Anyway, hopefully once we see, hopefully when I see you again, you will be looking like normal, and then we will ignore that question. One less question.
Yeah, then I won't have to explain that. I'll have to answer maybe the others.
Anyway, thank you very much for joining me, David. Good to have you with us, and hopefully we will see you again. And also thank you very much everyone who joined us in the chat. By God's grace, we will see you soon on another live stream or at Speaker's Corner or at the bosom of the Father, wherever, which place comes first. May Christ crucified silent you with his love until we see you.